Joel Campbell is an entrepreneur who really thinks outside the box. Joel came up with the ingenious idea of leasing old prisons and running prison tours and events inside them. In only 4 short years, Joel went from being £72,000 in debt, on the brink of bankruptcy with bailiffs knocking at the door, to now running a successful business which has been valued at over £1 million. Welcome to the call, Joel Campbell.
Yeah, I'm good, thank you.
Well, listen, the main reason I wanted to bring you on the show, I want you to tell us all about the prison. It's a very interesting story, but I know you've been like doing some new kind of business deal today. So do you want to tell us about that as well?
Yeah, well, I guess we've actually, funny enough, been chatting with the owners of one of the prison sites today, because we've had to, we're at that kind of time where we've been there indefinitely for a couple of years now, 4 years, and they're getting ready to start the development work. So actually starting to do something with this site. And that meant that we were having to renegotiate our deal, or they were renegotiating our agreements. And that was, to be honest, we haven't really gone out to the public with it yet. So you're kind of the first person to hear. We haven't even told a number of our employees yet. But it was, we weren't exactly sure what that was going to look like. And there was a potential that it would have meant that we would have left that prison, or would have left that site, which would have completely changed our business, and we'd have gone on and done something else. So it was quite a big day for us. We've been building up to it for about 2 weeks, so it's quite a big day to kind of thrash that out with the owners and kind of and see how that all looks, really. But let me step back, I guess,
because tell people what you do, because the people listening don't know what you do.
No, that's exactly it. So I run a number of different businesses. We've got like an overarching parent company, if you will. And then we've got lots of other businesses underneath. I say lots of other businesses. We've got 5 other companies. And we basically have investments and such inside different businesses. Some that are ours, some that are run by other people. And we just have a horse in the race, if you will, or a stake in them somewhere along the lines. And I kind of fell into prisons. It was 2014, so I'd found myself that my first company I'd set up in 2011 had basically pretty much gone into, not quite gone into administration, but was about to go into administration. I sold it to a London-based PLC, so to a London healthcare company, for like 11 grand. So it was nothing. It had thousands of pounds worth of debt. So sold it for 11
that,
grand.
That was your heart rate monitor thing, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, a company called Step Success. So I never talk about it enough, which is bizarre, because I'm really proud of it, because it was my first business ever. But we were the first UK company to start doing mobile activity tracking applications in the UK. So we got there before the likes of like Fitbit and stuff like that. The only other player really in that world was Nike. We were in there before Apple and stuff, which is bizarre to be in that kind of world of device tracking. But I soon realized that I thought we were a health provider. So my concept was it takes people from inside gyms, which is predominantly, as you'll be aware, normally people that are kind of health seekers, so people that are already kind of fit and healthy that want to go to the gym, want to exercise. It's a small percentage of the population. I was trying to target the couch potatoes, if you will, people that didn't want to go to gyms. And we were doing it by giving them tracking, activity tracking devices, and engaging them with mobile apps, things like through Facebook and stuff like that. And I thought I was running a healthcare company, which was going to get people healthier and live better. And it very quickly turned out to be a web-based company. It very quickly turned out to be an application company. Actually, we specialized more in developing the mobile app and the experience rather than the activity and the programming. And it's such a hard market. I mean, it's a brilliant market. I love it. I loved it so much. I love the technology aspect. It really got me into it. I learned how to code mobile apps and stuff like that.
I was just going to ask you what role you played, and did you have a team, and like who was doing what?
It was just me. It was literally just me, and my stepdad did my accounts for me, and my what is my wife now, but my partner back then, my girlfriend, helped like do some of the website stuff. And then I outsourced the actual app to an external guy who I just basically paid as a self-employed basis to build me this app. And then I learned to kind of do some coding myself. because I just got more into it. I just got interested in it. It was amazing. It was great to sort of do, and a brilliant experience to learn. And I built my own mobile app at some point down the line. So it was a great skill to do, but it's such a hard job because it's so specialized and it costs so much. And then the big players in it, like the Fitbits of this world and, you know, Facebook's this world, and app developers, you know, they're so good at what they do. So that one unfortunately kind of went belly up. I made a lot of wrong decisions as a company owner. I think as a lot of company owners will say that I think I probably made every decision, every bad decision under the sun you could do.
In the spirit of learning from mistakes, could you highlight a couple of them? You know, what was the biggest lessons in terms of business lessons?
I certainly spent far too much money on PR, and I think I let the PR company lead me rather than me lead them. So they kind of sat down and said, we're going to target this market because that's going to be, you know, the easiest market for us to target. And I was like, yeah, but that's the one that makes me no money, and it's going to take me so long to make a return. My business will fold in the meantime. But I let them kind of lead me. I don't think I was strong enough to say no. This is the way that I want to do it.
So that was with marketing the device?
With PR. Yeah, they wanted to basically go out purely to like individuals and literally compete in the Nike world and the Apple world and what was going to become Fitbit world, and compete with Fitbit that I think at the time had a market cap of like, I think it was $20 million or something like that. And I was a tiny, you know, one-man band working out of my front room basically. So that was never gonna work. So I think I spent far too much money on PR. Whereas I could have just, I now know I could have just done that myself, like done some really clever Facebook advertising and spent the money there. And predominantly I just didn't have enough capital to keep it going. I think that was the bottom line. Even though the overheads were low, I still had to live because I plowed everything into it. And I was chasing really big clients like Network Rail and Tesco's, who we had on contracts, and we were trying to chase them down to have them on retainers for like 5 years. So I was spending a huge amount of time working with really big companies that, in fairness, if they'd come off, probably would have seen us, you know, able to sell the company for, you know, a few hundred thousand pounds, maybe even more, but they didn't. And in the meantime, I spent so much time working on them, I didn't deal with a number of smaller businesses and smaller contracts, which would have built our foundation and allowed us to have a solid foundation continuously and grow and go after the big contracts. So I kind of went around it the wrong way. That was a bit of a risk, and it backfired. And then just a number of other mistakes that you make along the way, spending money in the wrong places, not putting your time in the right places. I think I spent too much time on the road, running up and down to meetings rather than being confident to have them over the phone and over the internet and stuff like that. So there's a lot of wasted time in the car and just stuff like that, really, and just generally inexperience.
If you were back in the same position marketing that same product with the knowledge and the experience you've got now, do you believe it would have, you know, done a lot better, given you a bigger payday?
Yeah, if I knew then what I know now, I think I certainly could have built it to a decent size, where I think I probably would have then positioned to sell it to like Fitbit, Fitbug, a healthcare company, maybe Nuffield, something along those lines. I think we could have generated enough interest and a big enough customer base to be able to sell it to a bigger company, and probably would have built that platform. Because I came out the back of it, selling it basically to a healthcare company I sold it to in London. They basically paid £11,000 for it, but part of that deal was I got lumbered with a lot of the debt, so I ended up with £72,000 worth of debt out the back of it. So it was a really difficult time for me, and for my wife, because we had a house, but it was mortgaged up to the hilt. We owed £72,000. We had bailiffs literally knocking on the door.
All right, you've done all that then.
Yeah, we had a newborn that she was about, I think, 12 months old.
What year was this?
This was 2012.
Okay.
2012. And I can remember having literally £1.57 in our bank account, and we were living off pasta and pesto. And we just were thanking our lucky stars that our daughter was young enough that she was still being breastfed because we couldn't afford to feed our child.
Jesus Christ.
And I mean, it sounds extreme and it was difficult, but I guess I knew I could turn it around eventually. And I think we also were secure enough that, because we were about to lose our house, that, you know, we weren't going to be homeless on the streets. We just had to have moved in with my parents, for example. But you know, it was a difficult time. It was a time that you have to kind of knuckle down. I guess some people will take that. Some people get very depressed from those kind of situations. Other people, you know, bounce back and thrive off it. And I'm certainly the latter. So that had happened. And then I was dabbling around doing a few different bits and pieces. Obviously we connected from when we were doing the paddleboard stuff. So we were doing some, things with paddleboards where we'd imported some paddleboards from China. I had somebody I knew, in Bristol who was a bit of a mentor of mine. He knew that I had loads and loads of debt and I still managed to persuade him to lend me $8,000 so I could import some paddleboards from China. So I did that, and I sold them, paid him back, was able to buy some more, sell some more, and did that for a little bit. But we also ran it as a bit of a media platform. And that was kind of more of a hobby and just learning more about social media marketing, Facebook marketing, and stuff like that. And then the prisons went up for sale. Shepton Mallet prison went up for sale along with 7 other jails. And I'd always said it would make a great tourist attraction. And I wasn't really doing a huge amount at the time. So I just thought, sod it, I'll put a bid in to buy the place. So I put a bid in to buy a 2.5 acre jail that was 400 years old. And I did what I do, which is very different to most people. I think a lot of really true cut entrepreneurs will do, which I went totally against the grain and I went in a completely different direction to everybody else. And it really paid off for us. I think that was the start really for the Campbell group beginning in its growth, and for the jail world.
Jesus Christ. What a story. My God. And look, I didn't realize you bought the prison.
Well, we didn't buy that one, and that's kind of what happened, because the trouble was there was loads of developers pitching to build houses, and there was basically with something like the prison, when you're buying something like that off the government, there's a number of pieces of paperwork you have to complete. There's some stuff about who you are and what you do, and such like that. So make sure you're a solid purchaser. There's also a sheet about how much is your bid and where you're going to raise that funds from, and then proof of funds. And developers were bidding different amounts of money and stuff like that. And I basically bid £1 and said it's not worth any more than that because it's cost so much to run. But I provided them, because I knew they wanted it as housing, I provided them a 72-page document which detailed and stipulated how it could be converted into a tourist attraction. And to get them to take me seriously, I launched a website which basically showcased that entire bid, and I publicized our entire bid in every aspect all the way through, and just built loads of media attention around it, just loads and loads of media attention.
To add weight so that they kind of couldn't ignore the public interest.
Yeah, that was exactly it. We built such a public interest that they couldn't ignore us. They had to take our bid seriously. And we got shortlisted to the final three and just pipped at the post, which was fair enough because, again, I was a one-man band out my front room. I still had no money. I had $72,000 worth of debt. I just knew a little bit more than I'd known a few years before.
So you're telling me that so because there was a lot of your proposal involved like public, it was going to be an attraction for the public.
Yeah,
so it's going to
fit
the community. And so the council viewed that favorably and they allowed you to do that, even though you weren't bidding like the property developers were bidding. But because it was for the public, they went with it.
Yeah, exactly that. So we were bidding to the Home Office because it was the Ministry of Justice that was selling it. So it was through a big international agent, Jones Lang and LaSalle, which is a huge international global corporation. And everyone was so pissed. Sorry, I'm going to swear. Everyone was so annoyed at us. The agents were so annoyed at me because every time they had to give me information because I was a bidder, but every time I did it, it went on our website and got released to the media. And they hated that because these things are normally done so confidentially and so like behind closed doors. Yeah. And I just wasn't going to do that. And they hated it. And I even turned around and I persuaded them to allow me to tour counselors around the site. So before we'd even the bid had been announced, we were touring people around the site, showing them what we were going to do. And yeah, they found me really difficult to contend with, really difficult.
Oh, I see. So where did you get this kind of audacity and tenacity? Because you clearly think outside the box. And have you always been that way? I mean, we went to school together, so I know you when you were little, but where did you develop this? Was it always there? Did you get it from somewhere?
Yeah, and I think it's always been there. And I speak to my mum now because my kids are young. We actually home educate our children. My mum always says she wished she did that with me because I hated school. I really didn't do. I'm not particularly academic. I can remember when we were at school, you were always in slightly higher groups, and you were quite academic. And there were other people that I can think of that were in our class that were insanely smart, like really academically attuned. And they gone so well in school, and others that weren't. I can think of, myself and a number of others in my group, especially some of the farmers and stuff, particularly not academic. And I think, school wasn't particularly favorable for me in that sense. And it wasn't until a few years after I'd left that I kind of started stepping more into my own and kind of figure out what I want to do. And I knew I'd always wanted to run my business. I always loved It was really weird. I always really enjoyed watching you selling sweets. And that still resonates with me because I remember sort of seeing it, just going, that's such a genius idea. It was such a good way of doing it. But yeah, it wasn't until I got into my late, well, mid to late 20s that I was like, I definitely want to do this. This is what I want to do. I want to run my own business. I just have no idea what I'm going to do it in. And it just took a couple of years to kind of find the first thing, really, which was the activity tracking side of the world. And then once I'd lost my cherry, really, I guess there was no stopping me at that point. That was it. And you just learn as you go.
Right. Are you the kind of person who reads all the business books and studies all the business concepts, or are you more self-directed?
No, I do. No, I definitely read a fair bit. I haven't read for a while, but I've read a number of different autobiographies. I spend a lot of time looking at clips on YouTube, looking at clips on Instagram. I spend a lot of time on social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Not so much on Snapchat at the moment, but I do spend a lot of time. I do spend a lot of time looking at different business people, different successful people, some unsuccessful people, and trying to get a range and an approach of kind of what to do. I really believe in surrounding yourself with smart, intelligent people and people that you want to aspire towards, if that kind of makes sense. And because I can't surround myself with, hugely successful people in that sense, I do it by using social media because they're there. You just have to go and watch them.
Right.
If that makes sense.
You briefly mentioned a mentor in Bristol. Is that something you can tell us more about?
Yeah, I mean, that's the guy that who basically my he's connected through my family. My stepdad worked for him for a number of years. I guess he's got that same story as a number of business people have. He grew a business from nothing effectively in his own house with somebody else. He grew it to a good size. He went through some troubles and tribulations. He went through a really tough patch. He grew it to, I think it was about 18 million turnover in the end. And he sold it when he was in his mid-50s to a much, much bigger company, and basically retired off the profits. But he's been through the pain of a business, of growing a business from a one-man band up to 35, 40 employees and sort of 18 million turnover. So he's gone through the pain, so he understands it. So he very much helped me from the early stages to kind of where I am now, really. And whilst we're not anywhere near where he was in turnover, we're a different industry and we're kind of there in size. So he's helped me sort of, he's just given bits of advice and such like that. He's been a really useful person to be able to call on and just ask different questions at different points. And he doesn't charge you like an accountant or a solicitor would. So I think that's useful because it is having that knowledge set.
Those are my favorite kind of people, like the people that you can't pay. Like, if you had to pay them, you wouldn't be able to afford to, but if they like you, they'll help you. They're the best,
Absolutely.
aren't they?
Yeah. He's probably the only person I would say I've got a mentor, but I even the developers we work with and the different business people we work with, especially when we lease buildings, I will always try and drill into the owner to find out who they are, what they've done. I'll do a bit of research beforehand, so I'll figure out exactly, you know, what they've done, where they've had success, where they haven't, and I'll try and just pull little gems out of them. It's been quite interesting working because we work with a lot of property developers.
Just because we
lease properties at different points for different businesses, especially in the heritage world. So we've worked with a fair few property developers, some really big ones, some really small ones. So I'll be trying to pull out of them, and I'll be learning as we go about how you do planning applications and how you deal with architects and how you can think outside the box in terms of how you would design stuff and how you deal with the local community residents when you're putting together a bid and how you present yourself and how you go to the PR and the media and then actually how you do the whole process. And I can remember, I mean, I talk about jails all day, but back to jails very quickly. So I put the bid in for Shepton, wasn't successful. And off the back of it, the MOJ refused to release who'd won it. So I drew up a short list of, I think it was about 6 developers in the country that I knew could do it and would do it. And I basically just sent all of them an email. I sent the CEOs. So I did the age-old trick. I don't know if you've ever done this, but I because you don't always have the top people's emails on their website, I took their web addresses, their URLs, and I just did a combination of different emails, their first initial dot, their last name, their first name, last name, stuff like that, until I found the right email address. Mm-hmm. And I pinged them all emails just saying, hey, I think you might have bought this prison. We bidded for it as well. This is what we'd want to do for it. I'd love to speak to you about me, take it over in between you buying it and developing it, and we'll do it as an interim. A guy came back to me, a guy called Trevor Osborne, who owns the Malmaison Hotel in Oxford. So he emailed me back to say that he hadn't bought Shepton, but he had just bought Shrewsbury Prison. And he'd be more than willing to speak to me about Shrewsbury and see if that was something I'd like to do. And long story short, I think that was in the January, and in the July, we opened the doors at Shrewsbury Prison to start doing guided tours. And I relocated myself at that time. And then a month later, I relocated my Emma, my partner, and our daughter. And by that point, our son as well, because this was 2015 by now. So I moved from Somerset to Shrewsbury, and we opened the doors.
So in terms of doing the tours and stuff, there's a big entertainment element to it. So are you the creative force behind coming up with the show, or is there other creatives that are involved with producing that?
It's a combination now. I mean, when we first did it, it was me and 3 ex-prison officers in their 50s and 60s, basically, who'd all worked at that prison. And we basically just started running guided tours. And they just basically took people around the site and explained to them what they used to do as a job. Right. And everyone loved it. But we didn't dramatize it. What we did was we played to what people expected. So I didn't just have the officers wander around. They dressed up in their full uniform. And when people arrived, we opened these great big wooden gates and people would come in and there'd be a call on the radio from one officer to another and they'd come and get them and they'd pretend they were prisoners and stuff like that. And they'd tell loads of jokes and really good anecdotes. And they would take them around for 2 hours and people loved it. And we just kind of built off that, and we started designing night tours, and we started designing different events and stuff like that. And yeah, predominantly I would say I was probably the key driving force in it. But then we have a lot of other people that have had influence in it. So it's been created by a number of different people over time and adapted and improved like that.
Okay.
Go on.
I was going to say, in terms of you must have 1,000 ideas in your head at any one time, and what systems or productivity apps or software or how do you organize your thoughts and get them down so that they can be executed or they can be delegated? What do you do?
It depends what it is. I mean, I live for tech. I really do, and I try and use as much technology as I can across all of our businesses to simplify the process, not necessarily to take the people out of the process, but to make it work better. So we use everything we use is there's an app somewhere for it that we're connected to. In terms of me personally, for my different ideas, I do something as simple as I just keep a spreadsheet, which I've got on here. Actually, I can't see on my desktop at the moment, but I've got one, and it's just called Joel's Ideas. And it literally is two columns. And one is like a title, and the other one is a description. And that is it. And I've got something like here, I've got like a pebble skimming app. And it literally is just, this is a pebble skimming app. And it just says people download the app, they open the app, and basically they press the screen and a pebble launches across the water. And depending on how many times they tap it is how many times it skims, and you can skim over waves and other rocks and people on boats and stuff like that. And it's just nothing more than pressing your screen. And it's just an idea I had once. I wrote it down and it just still sits on my list and has never come to anything more than an idea. and there's like you said, there's hundreds of those. Some are like that, and others are ideas for full businesses. I've built one called Employee View, which was trying to simplify the employment laws for employees, because it's so complex. And I was just trying to do like a dummy's guide. I was like, oh, we could just build an app of Employee View. And I was like, actually, it'd be really cool if employees could then rate the company they work for anonymously and say, give it like stars based on like their manager, based on the company ethos, based on their pay, like all that kind of stuff. And it becomes almost like a trip advisor for businesses. I was like, that'd be quite cool. And then, yeah, so there's various bits and pieces like that. One called Toy Swap, which was all about people being able to swap and donate and sell old toys. And the beauty is now all these things you can build onto other platforms. And then, yeah, more larger ones. Funny enough, I looked at when Toys R Us went under. I was desperate to buy that, but I just had no idea where to even start. HMV, funny enough, I looked at the other week when that was going to administration. And the airline, which went down the other day, which I posted on my social media pages. I was like, I could totally go for this. so there's kind of no limit to it in that sense.
So that's how you get your creative thoughts down. And then what system do you use for interacting with your team and delegating stuff?
We use a lot of Facebook Messenger. There's a lot of messages. We have got so many Facebook groups, so many Facebook Messenger groups. So we use a lot of that because everyone's connected to it. We obviously use email. So we're an Apple-based company, but we do use a Microsoft platform. So we use a lot of Outlook and emails. And then we use a system called Deputy, which is basically an employee management system, if you will. So employees, all of our employees sign on through Deputy. So when they start a shift, they sign in through there for timesheets. We use it for communication. We use it for training, for HR. We use it for all of our scheduling. And everyone's connected to that. So every single employee has a Deputy account and basically accesses that. So when they turn up on site, they just log in through their phone. And when they leave, and then we can ping messages back and forwards through that and group messages and stuff like that. But okay. We're still small enough that I can go and see two-thirds to three-quarters of my team I can go and see personally, and the others I can speak to on the phone. I try and do that as much as I can because they get to see me. And quite often I send people video or voice messages. I do send emails, but I'll quite regularly now sort of just record something and I'll email it to them. But yeah, I mean, they say that's because I like my own voice, so I can hear myself in like three different offices at once, which may be true.
I've started doing that recently. There's something a little nicer about it than texting. I mean, it's quicker because you can get your stream of consciousness just out, and also you can do it while you're driving. But also there's something a little bit more personal about people actually hearing your voice, you know, isn't there? You
can... It's tone.
Yeah.
I put up a... I had a few of my team the other day, I can say this because I put up on social media, which was a few of my team had asked, not asked me or asked my ops director, but asked another member of our team about pay rises this year. And they were kind of tiptoeing, sort of trying to fish the information. And I sent them an internal email to say that I understand you've been asking questions. And basically said I was a little bit disappointed that people hadn't come to me directly. But I understood that, you know, maybe they didn't want to. And I put a post up then on social media about them getting, you know, about what we were going to do in terms of our pay rises and things like that. But yeah, I like to do it because what ended up happening with that was some of my team turned out and said, we weren't going to respond to your email because it sounded really harsh. But then we watched your video and we kind of understood what you were saying. And it's because the email is just, it's just words that don't have any tone to it.
Yeah. Yes. So it's one of the reasons I've always done video, and I do video as much as I can, is because, you know, when people see you, they connect, they understand you a lot better, don't they? You know? Another, I got loads of questions in my mind, but you talked about, you've got the umbrella company and the prisons, but what other businesses are you doing beside the prison thing?
So we've got what is called the Campbell Group, aptly named. Funny enough, I never wanted to call it that. I just couldn't come up with a better idea. It was just really sad. Normally I come up with great ideas instead of my team, but none of us could come up with a better idea, so we just called it that, which is our parent company. It's where our central team all sits. It's where our central employees sit. It's where our marketing department is, our operations department, our admin, HR and finance. And it's kind of literally is an overarching resource, if you will. We've got two different prisons now, and we've got those separated into two different entities because they're completely different agreements, slightly different jails, slightly different locations.
Shepton Mallet and Shrewsbury, is it?
Yeah, so yeah, we've got those two.
Right.
They trade under the same brand, but they are separate companies. We've got an events company called Immersive Events, which deliver what it says on the tin. Basically, the customer becomes part of the story, and the decisions they make and the choices they take during an event dictates how the event unfolds and what happens next. So, you know, it's very much, do you want to take the left door or the right door? It's kind of the red pill or the blue pill type of situation. And there's always a couple of outcomes to it. And people love that because it is, you are part of the event. You are part of the whole process. And we're very good. We're specialized at kind of really pulling people in and immersing them into the process. So we do that in a range of different events, horror events, action events, escape events. So we run all those at the jails. We run those at the jails, but we're going to expand that to another location in Birmingham at some point later in the year. We've then got our children's fun houses. So we've got a range of soft play centers. That we operate. And again, one of those is built into the jail. So that's called Ashland's Fun House. Which is, you know, completely different from the other stuff we do, but again follows the same ethos that all of our companies follow. And then just about five weeks ago, I took a third share in a production company. So we're going to film the first production on Monday. Starts filming Monday for 3 days. So that's kind of where we're up to at the moment and what we're doing. And then we've got lots of different plans for this year in terms of how we've strategized the year, if you will.
And what's the production company you're going to be doing?
So the first production we're doing is a reality-based TV game show. So we're going to be doing that. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. I can't say too much about it because it hasn't happened yet. But basically, we're filming a pilot, which we're then going to take and pitch to commissioners to try and get an entire series commissioned. That's the theory there, with plans of grandeur of being able to get the series commissioned and then take it to license it and then sell it internationally. I don't know if we'll get that far, but just getting something commissioned in production world is a massive deal.
And with the kids' play areas, did you start that from scratch, or was that an existing business that you absorbed?
No, that's something we started from scratch. I've been talking about it for a while, and I had a lot of empty space at one of the prisons, and I wasn't doing anything with it. And I found I had some money at the time in the bank from the profits from the jail, and I basically found a children's play equipment online on eBay, so I bought it. I then had a couple of guys who build children's play centers come down, build it for us. And then we just kind of built it up from there, really.
Day to day, what's the majority of your time? I mean, how is your time divided? Are you dealing with day to day stuff, you know, dealing with
far too much.
Right.
Yeah. we've gone through a real journey, I would say. I mean, when we first started, I had a good amount of time, and I was really tuned into and this will sound really bad now, and other business owners go, oh my God, I can't believe he does this. But I was really tuned into the finances and what was going on, and I could tell you to the penny exactly where we were. As we've grown, what's happened is I've spread myself quite thin, and it's made me take my finger off the pulse a little bit with exactly where we are kind of financially. I've got other people that know that, which is good, and they can tell me. And actually, I've kind of found myself of late, probably over the last couple of months, actually far too much on the front line. I've been trying to remove myself from it, but actually I found myself today just answering emails directly to customers. I was just like, this is not my job, this is someone else's job, and because I'm doing that, no one's doing my job. So at the moment I'm finding myself far too much on the front line, and I need to get away from that. But there's a number of reasons for it, but that is a challenge. So yeah, I have lots of meetings. I meet a lot of time with my teams and with my staff. We've been doing a lot of strategy work at the moment, because the plan for the first five months of this year was to very much build our foundation more solid. So it's not bad, but I wanted a much more solid foundation so I could basically step away from the business permanently and it would still grow, not just operate, but actually grow. And we're 4 months into that. We're near enough on target. But what that has meant is I've had to step back into day-to-day operations to make sure all the systems and processes are in place. And it's probably going to be another couple of months before I can pull back from that.
That reminds me, I think it was Michael Gerber or somebody, there's some phrase where like your goal should be to fire yourself from your own business.
And yeah, I think I saw that. Every 5 years, quit.
It's something like that.
Is that one?
Yeah. I mean, you know, you get the point, don't you? You know, if we're actually involved in the day to day, then we can't sort of, you know, work on the more bigger picture stuff.
And also, you go stale. You continuously work on something. It is true. People do get, you know, you get stuck in a rut. And I think if you can remove yourself, I can't remember if it was the same one, but I saw somebody saying, you need, as a CEO or as a director, as somebody in the senior top position, you need to move on every 5 years. You need to effectively hire somebody else to do your job every 5 years, because they'll come in with fresh ideas and you need to get out of their way. I think one of the biggest challenges I've had, one of the hardest things, and I've got to that point now where I can do it, but a lot of my team haven't, is letting go. Is because when you're a small business, you do everything yourself. So everything's done your way meticulously, and you know that your way is the best way. And as you scale and you grow, you have to start giving other stuff to other people, and they do it differently. And I found myself so many times going, no, I want you to do it this way. And they're like, but why? And I'm just like, because this is the way I do it type of stuff. And you find you get caught in that trap. And then all of a sudden you're trying to do three people's jobs. You've got three employees, but you're trying to do all their jobs. And you realize you can't do all of this stuff, and you have to start letting go. And it's really difficult because they're not going to do it as well as I do it, because I know I do it the best, but actually they do it really, really well. They just do it different. And letting go of your baby is so tough. But once you've done that, once you've learned that, and you've kind of got over that, and you can give it to somebody else, suddenly your time kind of frees up. And it's like, oh, and I found myself a couple of times going, oh, now what do I do? And like I say, of late, I'm back in the systems and the processes world. But that is a tough one. I see it now in my managers not wanting to give their staff some of the roles and responsibilities. I'm like, guys, you've got to give it to them. And one of the things that my mentor said to me once, it didn't make a lot of sense when he first said it, but he said to me with employees, because I said to him, I've struggled to let go of this, and I've got all this workload. I'm working 100 hours a week. And he's like, you've got to let stuff go. And he basically said, you've bought the dog, let it bark. I was just like, what? He was like, you've bought the dog, you've got to let it bark. And what he was saying was effectively, you've employed that person. You've chosen to employ that person because you know they're the best person for the job and you trust them to do the job. So why aren't you letting them do the job? And that kind of really hit me quite hard. And I think it was the next day I was like, John, I'm just going to leave him to it. And that was it. And now I turn around to my employees. I say, I've bought the dog. I'm going to let you bark. And they complain to HR.
Oh, funny. That's really funny. Hey, what is it that drives you? Because you've clearly got a lot of excitement and a lot of drive. So what is it? Is it the money? Is it like you want to be successful for your own like personal accomplishment? Like what is it?
It does change. I mean, the motivation does change over time. But I live by three rules in business, and that's how I assess every business we look at. If we're going to buy it, invest in it, take it out of administration, start it ourselves. And what kind of motivates me is I live by the three rules. I want to be able to add value to something. So I want to be able to, I want to be able to say, well, we could do it like this, or we could do that. I want to have an input, but have that as a valuable input, not just wasted. It needs to be fun and exciting, because otherwise, what's the point? And it needs to be financially viable, so it needs to make money, because if it doesn't, you don't go anywhere. And I literally apply those three things to everything I do in business, and I encourage my employees to apply that to their lives as well. I always say to them that you need to earn, money needs to be an important factor in you enjoying your job. And you need to enjoy your job, you need to have fun doing it, and you need to be able to add value. And if you can't do those three things, do something else. And that's kind of what I apply to my business life, really. And that's kind of what pushes me. The motivation does change in different projects and different things. Sometimes we'll do a project, so I'm like, I want that to be the best tour in the world, or I want that to achieve, 50,000 people in the next year. I want it to achieve, 20 grand profit in the next couple of months. But generally, I try and abide by those three things, and they seem to have seen me pretty true since I put that into practice about 4 years ago.
So long term, how would you like to end up?
It's a really difficult one, because things change. I will never give up. My wife says to me sometimes, like, what's the plan for retirement? And she can tell I'm never going to retire. Like, I'll do this until the day I die. But the financial freedom is absolutely, something that I strive for. I strive for it for me. I strive for it for my family, for my employees, because you're at a point where, whilst everyone says that old cliche, money doesn't buy you happiness, and money doesn't bring all this, money doesn't do this, and that is true. But God, if you don't have to worry about money, life is a hell of a lot easier. Like, do you know what I mean? It's just this, and I find it really bizarre that people get really like nervous and unsettled about talking about it. And I'm just like, I don't get it. It's just, if you want to earn loads of money, what's the big deal? What's the problem?
I've rooted those people out of my life,
Yeah, I can
man.
appreciate that.
There ain't one left.
Yeah, I've dropped a lot of negative people off my Facebook page. It was kind of you that sort of, not just you, but you and a number of other people that kind of drove me to it when I was in New Zealand. And I just had enough of just seeing shit on my Facebook page of people like whinging about this and whinging about that. And I can say it now because I'm not friends with any of them, so I won't see them slating me. But I was just like, do you know what? Just unfriend, 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 unfriend. And I just kind of got rid of them. I was just like, that's not what I want to use my social media for. And yeah, and just, I love some of your posts. I really enjoy watching them. Some of them, I'm like, oh my God, that is close to the bone. And I'm amazed you don't get slated for them a bit more. And they're not necessarily exactly the way I would put it or exactly what I think, but some of them are so good because they're so, it's so honest and it's so true to like who you are and what you do. And I love that about the fact it's just like, this is what I say. I love the fact that you love Trump. Like,
I love Trump.
And I get where you're coming from with it as well. My mum will kill me for saying this, but I get where you're coming from, because what you can rely on Trump is he'll do what Trump does. He's an absolute pit bull, and he's completely driven. Whether you like him or hate him, this damn wall is going to happen, because he's just like, this is going to happen.
You know what? Early in our conversation, when you were talking about the prisons and now, and then you were going to the people and doing PR stuff and getting the public on your side, I was thinking that sounds very Trumpy, and I didn't want to say it because I didn't want to say the wrong thing, but.
Yeah, it is. It is like that. I remember when Trump got elected, I was just like, oh my God, I can't believe this has happened. And I do say to people that like anything is possible. And I remember a CEO saying to me when I was in the leisure industry, he was talking about Mark Zuckerberg, and he was saying, we now live in a world where like a 20-year-old can become a billionaire. Anything can happen. We live in a world where anything is possible. And I say that all the time about Trump. I'm like, Trump became president, anything is possible. It truly is. But I mean that in the most positive way I can. And yeah, it is. It's an exciting one. I threaten quite regularly. I've started joking with my close friends and with my close confidants in my business and my family. And I've started joking, saying, "Well, in 10, 12 years, when I run for prime minister, I expect your vote." And they're like, "What?" And I'll go, "Yeah, I might run for prime minister." And they're like, "You can't do that." I'm like, "Why not?" And they just stop and they kind of think, going, because that's what everyone said about the prisons. When I put the bid in for the prisons, they're like, "You can't do that." It's like, "Why not?" Like, why, who says you can't do it?
I'm still curious where you got this. Like, was your parents, like, did you get this from your dad or something, or were they different?
My mum ran a company when she was younger, but I'm quite resilient, but I think I just got to a point where I was like, who makes these rules that says you can't do it? And it was my stepdad said to me that I'm like a tiny percentage of the population. It makes me feel special, but it's like a 1% of the population, this tiny thing where I see this end goal. Like, I see, like, okay, I want to be prime minister, for example, or I want to start a company. And that's what I see is, I'm going to start this company. I'm going to take this company. I'm going to build it to, you know, X amount. I'm going to stick it on the stock market and it's going to flow and people are going to invest and it's going to be great. And I might retire and I might do something else. So that's what I see. What 99% of the population see is, I'd love to do this, but God, I'm going to have to think about employing people. Oh, now I'm going to have to think about HR. Oh, I'm going to have to think about insurance. Well, how am I going to pay my bills whilst I grow this? Oh, and then what's Jane next door going to think about it? And how am I going to do the marketing? Because I know nothing about marketing. And God, who am I going to use for finance? And suddenly all these negatives build up really quickly. And they completely outweigh this vision in the first instance. But I think true entrepreneurs, not people that call themselves entrepreneurs because it sounds cool, but true entrepreneurs don't have that. You have that end goal and all the rest of the shit you just figure out as you go. I had no idea how to do payroll until I employed my first people. And then I learned to do it there.
You're heavily outcome orientated, aren't you?
Yeah, absolutely.
You've got a strong, clear vision of what you want, and then you figure out a way of making it happen. Like you say, most people the other way around, they think of all the hassle it's going to take, and they just give up without even starting.
Yeah, and if you think of it as exactly that, if you think of it as a journey, I always sort of say to people, I think of it as a journey. If I wanted to go to like Scotland, I'd go, okay, I'm going to go to Loch Ness, and I'd jump in the car. I go, I know it's north. I wouldn't know which road I'm going to take, but I know where I'm going. And I would work out the road and I'd stop for petrol and food and stuff on the way. So it's just like that. And I think probably what drove me to it, and I think this is probably really important for anybody in business, is having failure. Having failure is the best lesson ever. And I think for me, having bailiffs banging on my door, and, you know, my wife answering when I wasn't there, or my partner at a time, and has got a baby and bailiffs on the door threatening to take the car and threatening to come in and take everything when we had nothing anyway, and then threatening to take our house, and, you know, constant letters of, you know, not paying bills and mortgages and being blacklisted by the bank, and these huge threats, which I know you've experienced as well. Those kind of things like make you go, well, I'm at kind of the bottom now. How worse can it get? And when I took over the jail, and I can say this because the developer won't watch this. I know he won't. But when I took over the jail, I was £72,000 in debt still. I had no money. I had nothing at all. And I basically made the agreement with the developer to take over the jail. I agreed a rental per month for what we were going to pay. I then hired employees. I got the insurance. And I had to do a few other costs. And I had no money, and literally I was looking at this going, in 30 days I have to find, I think it was 12 grand or something like that, just for the first month to pay the down payments and things like that. And I had no money, and I was just like, what's the worst that can happen? And we launched the website, and within 24 hours we sold £7,000 worth of tickets.
Wow.
And then over the next week we'd sold like 30 grand's worth of tickets. And I was just like, this is great. I can pay all my stuff. I can pay all the bills. I can do it. And I went on to PayPal, because we used PayPal at the time. And I went to withdraw the money, and PayPal was like, no, you can't have this money because you've not proved your identity, and EU rules state that we can't let you have it until you prove all your identity. And I couldn't release the funds till literally 2 days before payday.
Jesus.
But when I did it, Like, people think I'm mad when I tell people that story. They're like, that's so irresponsible of you. You know, you took on staff not knowing that you could pay them. How irresponsible. You know, imagine what if you couldn't pay them, and, you know, you made a deal with a developer that you couldn't foresee, and, you know, that's just so bad. And like, yeah, it is. But at the same time, I did pay them. I made it work.
So you dug yourself out of debt without going bankrupt?
Yeah, just literally by like, I don't know, 60, 90 days maybe.
There's something so much more interesting, like you just said, about people that have kind of hit rock bottom and come back. There's so much. And like, and it's like going to the gym and lifting weights. It makes you mentally stronger and everything, doesn't it?
It does. You can have a conversation with somebody that's been there, and you can tell, you can feel the pain, that they get it. They understand what it's like to have nothing and to have failed. And I don't always think it's the financial failure. It's how other people look at you and thinking about, God, how other people perceive me. And I'm not really worried about what other people think of me too much. It's kind of wards off a duck's back now. But I know back then I was like, God, what are my friends going to think? You know, my business has failed. Because when you start, everyone's like, yeah, you're going to do really well. And it fails. You're like, God, yeah, my business has failed. People are like, how's the business going? You're like, yeah, actually it's collapsed. And I think like we're going to lose our house. People are like, oh, that's not good. So you're going to go get a job? And I'm like, no. what do you mean I'm going to get a job?
Fuck you talking about, bitch.
That's crazy. I'm not going to get a job. They're like, you have to go get a job. You need to save your house, provide for your family. I'm like, if I get a job, I'm still going to be doing it when I'm 60.
I don't know if you saw this Gary V video, and he was saying like the people that sort of like inherited a load of money or a trust fund or something like that, you know, that they didn't have to earn it from scratch, like they're never gonna have that feeling of satisfaction of truly building something themselves. They're never gonna have that feeling. And it's not that they're bad people. There's nothing wrong with inheriting or being helped. You know, it's not, I'm not saying it's wrong, but there, in it, there's something great. You know, when you've built something from nothing, there's a pride and a self esteem that comes from that.
Yeah, there is, knowing you've carved it yourself. And I think there are entrepreneurs out there that they've, you know, raise their kids, and I think that's absolutely right. And I remember seeing an interview with Alan Sugar at one point, and he was, I can't remember who he was with, it was a number of years ago now, and they were talking about his kids, saying, you know, about your kids before I think it's Michael Sugar, his son, took over Amscreen, they were asking about how his kids had grown up. He was like, actually, do you know what, we're very lucky. He said, my wife's done a lot of the work, but we're very lucky because our kids could have grown up, you know, driving Ferraris, snorting cocaine and be party animals, and because actually they're very level-headed, and they've come into the business and kind of they've gone through, you know, university, come into the business at middle management level, and now they're working their way up. But you know, I guess the fundamental dream for a lot of people is you want your kids to take over your businesses, and you know, you want them to have the same goals and dreams and stuff like that. But yeah, it is, there is something about doing it yourself and creating it. I know someone that I'm friends with was actually 2 years below us in school, and their dad is very successful, been very, very successful in his business. And I remember his son went to work for him, and he was like, yeah, boss again, going to be in management, it's fine. He walked in and his dad stuck him on production line. He was like, what are you doing? He's like, you're going on production line. He's like, what? I'm not going to work in the office. No, you start at the bottom like everybody else. You want to work in the office, you claw your way up like everyone else. This is where you start. And if you don't like it, go somewhere else and find another job. And he taught him the humility that way. And like, you know, he did. He worked hard and he learned it. So I think it's, you know, how it goes. But my kids are homeschooled, so they've got a very different upbringing. And it is...
What's the thinking behind that? Tell us your decisions with...
We don't really agree with the way schooling's done. I don't know what your thoughts are on it, actually. I don't see you post about schooling particularly. But the thing with school is it is, and we've got friends that are teachers that will explain it as a sausage factory. Every child goes in different, and they all come out the same way. And I fundamentally don't like school and the education system because it teaches you to go to school. And this was like this when we were at school. Go to school, like 9 till 3 or whatever the hours are. Work hard whilst you're there. Say to the teacher, call them sir or miss. because that's what's always happened. They teach you, you know, absolutely fundamentals of English and maths and science and stuff, but they teach you a lot of stuff that you'll never use again. And they teach you stuff so you can remember it to pass an exam. And at the end of that, and then when you finish school, you go home and you take homework with you. So you finish school, you go home, and you do homework. And then it conditions you. So when you leave school, eventually they tell you to go get a job, you know, buy a car, buy a house, all those kind of stuff. And then when you finally go to work, you get to work and you do your 9 to 5 at work and you take work home with you and you work at home because that's what you've learned to do from school.
Yeah,
no. And I really dislike that because I hated it at school. I really did. And I never did my homework, which is why I always got in trouble. But I was like, why should I work at home? This is time to go out and play, ride my bike, play with my friends and you know, that kind of stuff. And I think that's so much more important for kids. And our daughter did go for the first year. She went for the first year of school when she was 4. I think she just turned 5. I remember that she came home one day really upset, and she really doesn't like school at all, but she came home really upset because the teacher had told her off because she'd colored in a giraffe blue. She brought the picture home and it had a cross on it, and she told off because she colored a giraffe in blue and giraffes aren't blue. I was like, she's like 5. Can you tell a 5-year-old they've colored something wrong? How is that even possible? And I don't like the fact that you get fined if your kids don't go to school. I just think the whole... For me, the whole thing just goes against my grain. It truly does. I think that's the same with a lot of entrepreneurs. And it was the same for my wife. She really disliked a lot of the school system. And we both worked full-time in the business at the time. And we took the kids out of school. And Emma was working full-time in the business. She was doing about 45 hours a week in the business. And she was trying to home educate our 2 kids as well. It was a real challenge, but it was just the way we decided to do it. And it was funny because we learned loads doing that, because actually we discovered that in schools, we don't opt out of school, you opt in. So when you start your children at school, there's a form you sign to put a child into school, and that is you officially opting into the system. And if you don't fill it in and don't sign it, you're not part of the system. And believe it or not, there's no law about sending kids to school.
I was just going to say, I didn't realize you get fined. I was going to say, don't you get fined?
No, there's no law about sending kids to school. You only get fined if you opt into the system.
Really?
Yeah, so because you opt into it. And people now say, wow, you took your kids out of school. And we're like, no, we didn't. You opted into school. We just didn't do that. We just chose not to do that. And there's you have to provide a child an education, but there's an argument about what is an education. My kids, their handwriting might not be quite as neat as children of the same age. They can both read. They might not tell the time as quickly. Their maths might be different. But my daughter could teach fundamentals of economics. She can tell you how economics works and how business economics works. That a customer comes through the door, pays money. That money goes into the bank via an electronic system or via cash. And at the end of the month, we have to pay our staff, we have to pay our bills, and what's left is profit, and we can pull off the profit to live. The more people that come through the door, the more profit, the more things she can have. Mm. She gets the fundamentals of economics.
Yeah.
And you know, she can count £100 quick as an adult. But just because she's been around the business. So yeah, I think it's horses for courses, really.
And how does it work? Like, do they send social workers to check up on you and shit like that?
No, they can do, but they don't. We're kind of left to our own devices. And it's been an interesting journey, because one of the things that concerns me most, and I say to my wife quite a lot, because she's very level-headed, you know, she's level-headed, come from slightly different backgrounds. She definitely comes from much more of a working-class background, whereas I would say my background is more middle-class. I mean, I grew up in the Dew Valley. I'm very, not to say very lucky, but I had parents who had good jobs and good businesses. You know, we've always owned our own houses. I've never had to worry about where my next meal's coming from. Went to good schools, and stuff like that. We lived in nice areas, you know, as you did. She comes from, you know, much more of a working-class background. So she's quite level-headed, but I always get concerned that because we've been 72 grand in debt, you know, we've been about to lose everything. I can remember eating pasta and pesto, and if we could afford cheese, it was a luxury. And that went on for about 9 months. We couldn't put the heating on. We just wore extra blankets, extra jumpers, and we just bought our house, our second house, funny enough. in just outside Shrewsbury, in a tiny little village, and it's 3,000 square, just 3,500 square feet. So it's just under 300 square meters. It's on an acre of land. It's, you know, got 20 rooms. It's got four big bedrooms. It's got a swimming pool.
Jesus Christ.
Big drive, you know, big double garage, which I've built a gym into. I'm sat at the moment in a home education room, which is filled with all the stuff that the kids do in home ed. I'll show you. So, you know, we've now done this. So we're at the other end now, if you will, of the spectrum. And that's taken me 4 years. In 4 years, I've gone from £72,000 in debt to a company that's valued at just over £1 million. And we've been able to buy all those things, paid off all of our debt. We own no money. We own two houses. And we've done all those kind of things. And I get concerned that as we do that, I will forget what it was like to have the pain. I'll forget what it was like to have the pasta and the pesto. So I try and get her to keep my feet on the ground a little bit. So it's a journey. But, you know, some people look at and say that I've you know, not paid my employees enough potentially, or I'm it's different, which I don't listen to too much. The bottom line is I worked 100 hours a week, 52 weeks of a year for 4 years. And I poured my heart and soul into it, and I cried for it, I bled for it, I sweated for it. And, you know, we kind of now have, at a relatively young age of 35, a house that most people look at and go, well, we can get that when we're 50. And for me, that's just kind of a starting point. Wow. So, yeah, it's hard, but it can be done.
Wow, well done, Joel. That's really cool. Yeah, nice job. Sorry. Really cool. Maybe the holding company should have been called Pasta and Pesto.
Oh, shit. That's a great idea. That's a brilliant idea. Pasta and Pesto.
It'd be a good name for a book or something, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be. I'm definitely trying to write my book at the moment. I just never find the time to sit down and do it. I'm desperately trying to write my first book. Just to kind of, yeah, go through. I love doing videos. I love social media. And I came up the other day with you know, the next thing. I've recently been watching a lot of old videos of Steve Jobs and Mark Zuckerberg and various other people, some Bill Gates bits and pieces, but some early videos of their presentations launching new products, and just because it's kind of reignited for me a bit of fire about kind of what I want to do next. And I'm all about the Amazon Echo world and the Alexa world and voice recognition, partially because I'm just trying to kit my house out with voice recognition software so I can control everything. And I'm trying to find, at the same time, I'm sort of finding a gap in the market for what you can and can't do with voice recognition software and things. So I've been toying with that. But yeah, I guess the next step for us, because I don't want to bore you too much, is we continue doing the prisons. We had a very productive meeting today with the developers. That's looking really positive in terms of how that's going to go. We're going to grow our event company. The fun houses will grow, probably not as fast as the other businesses, but they'll still grow. And my next thing now is we'll spend another month to 2 months working on that. And my plan is that from that point, I'll be able to step away from the day-to-day operations fully and then start looking at other opportunities. And at the moment, I'm not necessarily looking to start a new company because it's a very different type of graft, but it's not the type of work we want to do at the moment. What I'm looking to do is actually start investing in other businesses. I always keep an eye on stuff from administration. I don't know if you spend much time looking at companies coming out of administration.
I've never done that. I was going to ask you, actually, where are they listed?
There's various places. I mean, insolvency practitioners are a pretty good place to get them, because what you want to do, and what I've done, is I've spent some time with four or five different insolvency practitioners, people that deal with administration of companies, prepackaged administrations and stuff. And I've just basically dropped them an email and said, hey, this is who I am. And I did this years ago as well. I've been doing this for about 3-4 years now, kind of similar to the time when I had the jails. And I've dropped them emails and just said, hey, you know, my name's Joel, I do this, I've got this company, and I'm always on the lookout for companies going to administration. These are the types of businesses I would be interested in. Let me know if anything comes along. Because administrators, they want to sell a business. They don't want it to collapse. They'd much rather find a buyer to take it on. It has got easier because now I can turn around and say, hey, I'm Joel. I'm the CEO of the Campbell Group of Companies. Last year, we turned over 1.2 million. We've got, you know, three premises. We've got, you know, 6 acres of real estate that we operate from. You know, it's easier. They take you more seriously. But I still turn up. I mean, today I'm wearing a shirt, but quite regularly I still turn up in like a polo shirt and a hoodie and sometimes trainers. And they're just like, what is this guy? The other day I turned up to a meeting. We were bidding on a, we were potentially looking to bid on a new project. And it was last year when it was really hot. It was really, really baking. And I went up and I got dressed in the morning. I was like, oh God, I'm going to have to wear a suit. And it was like 27, 28 degrees or something. I was like, I'm going to have to wear a suit because I'm going for this project meeting. I was like, no, fuck it. I'm not doing it. It's not me. And I put on a pair of shorts and I put on a t-shirt. And I turned up and everyone, I walked in late as well, which was not good. And everybody, the whole auditorium, about 30 odd people, all suited and booted, all guys, all executives, all in nice ties and nice suits, all turned around. They're like, who is this guy? And I was just like, it doesn't matter how I dress, you're still going to get the same Joel.
Yeah.
Whatever I wear.
I much prefer those kind of guys that sort of step out of a Bentley dressed like shit. You know, they're my favorite. You know?
Yeah. And there are people that do it on purpose, but it's just, do you know what? I saw it with Zuckerberg, funny enough. Why does Mark Zuckerberg always wear the same clothes? And his answer was, I have loads of the same jeans and the same t-shirts because I like wearing them. They're comfortable. But more importantly, it's one less thing I have to make a decision about in the morning. I don't have to think about what I'm going to wear. And I was like, God, the amount of times that I sort of get up and I'm like, what am I going to wear today? And you kind of procrastinate about that. And your first thought of the day is, what am I going to wear? Rather than kind of your focus is on where you want it to be, which is in your business, I guess.
Are you a holiday person? Like, I'm not a holiday person. Like, for me, I don't really want to go. I enjoy what I do. What about you?
Yeah, no, I love being in the sun or in the snow, but I can't switch off. I can't do it. I mean, I go to New Zealand for 6 weeks of a year. I mean, in fairness, my in-laws live over there. They emigrated, so we only have to pay for our flights, and we live at their house effectively, so we don't have to pay, you know, accommodation. But yeah, we went for 45 days this year, 46 days, and I worked for 40 of them. And I can't do it. We're going to Dominican Republic this year for two weeks. And my wife's like, we can sit by the pool for 2 weeks. I'm like, I'm taking my Mac. And she's like, you can't. I'm like, I'm doing it. And yeah, I can probably do it for maybe 2 days, maybe 3 days. I could just do nothing. And then I'd have to do it.
This is like a big change in my lifestyle because I used to spend like loads of time hanging around with yoga people and stuff like that. And like, they got very different values to me. You know, their idea of a good time is kind of, you know, traveling around in a camper van, backpacking, going to India, you know, spending some time in a silent retreat. And I'm thinking, what the fuck am I doing here? Like, this is the opposite of anything I'm interested in. I couldn't give a fuck about that shit. You know, so it was like relatively recently, only this year, that I kind of reconfigured my lifestyle, and you know, I feel like I'm much more myself. You know,
yeah, that makes sense, and it is. It's figuring out kind of what you want to do, and things change as well over time. Like, you know, you change your goals, change your motivation, changes, and who you want around you changes. And I've cut big groups of people out of my life at different points. I went through a period in my mid 20s where I was probably doing far too many drugs, and I was surrounded by loads of people that were in that world, and I desperately wanted to get out of it. So the only way to do it was to kind of cut all these people loose. And some of these were really good friends of mine. And fundamentally, I've still got, you know, some really close friends from when I grew up, but over time I've actually cut different people out. And yeah, you kind of have to make the sacrifices, I guess, at different points for what you want to achieve.
Yeah, absolutely. It does change, doesn't it? I've been kind of reconnecting a lot more, like with people like yourself and other people that are just more on the same wavelength as me lately. And it's like, you know, less people, but better quality people.
Yeah, and some of the people I see on Facebook, I mean, I'm connected with some of the people we went to school with, and I see bits and pieces. And I love seeing what the guys doing, like Matt and Wayne. I love seeing what the farmers are doing, because that's such a hard graft. I really take my hat off to them, because they work equally as long hours as I do, they're far more physical hours in terms of what they do, and they're running their own businesses as well. But it's a very different style of what they're doing. I kind of, people say to me, going, oh, Joel, when you take over the world, can you do this for me? And that's kind of how people perceive me, because of the drive. Mm-hmm. But yeah, and I saw pictures of Chris Packwell the other day, because he's quite hench, isn't he? He's quite pumped. He's spent a fair bit of time in the gym.
Yeah, it's funny. I reconnected with Chris when I started getting into weightlifting stuff about 5 or 6 years ago, and we just bumped into each other randomly at the gym. You know, he lived in the same area, and I hadn't seen him since school. You know, I hadn't seen him for 15 years, and we reconnected, and it's nice. And Alex Bethune is doing well. He's got his tent glamping company, and he's doing really well.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm going to get him on the podcast, actually. You know, he's got a buzz and a zest for life as well. So he's got a few stories to tell. And really, like...
Yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah,
Have you seen Josh Eggleton? He's a great one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, right. I haven't seen him. I haven't seen him, but what's he doing?
You've got to check out Josh. I mean, Josh was an absolute... dick at school. I mean, I wasn't any less of a dick, but Josh was a complete knobhead, and I think he'd probably, I'd like to think he'd agree with that.
We'll find
he's
out.
He's a Michelin star chef, and he owns the Pony and Trap.
Him oh and yeah, I knew that. Holland. Yeah, I know that.
And he's amazing. I got invited down to Port 11 Food Festival a couple of years ago, and he was down there. Presenting down there, so I went and watched one of his presentations, and the guy's he's amazing, he is so good. And I sort of look at him, I'm like, man, at school you were a dick, and like I'm just looking at him now going, you're so different. And it is amazing how much people sort of change. But yeah, no, I think he's done a brilliant job. I think because, you know, chefing's such a hard industry, and the pub trade is so hard, and I think he's incredibly talented, but he's worked so hard to build that skill set.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll take my hat off to that.
I'll get in touch with him and reconnect. Well, listen, it's been fascinating hearing that story. That is an incredible story. 72 grand in debt to over a million.
I mean, the millions in the company, in fairness, I don't see that much of that. But it is interesting how you do it, because when we went to buy this house, I'll sort of leave you with this, and it was, you learn to do things in different ways, and I've been having this thing recently with a lot of people about rich people, because there's this big theory that rich people hoard all the money. And I really kind of go against that, because I see, I spend a lot of time with people that are quite wealthy as well. Very few wealthy people I know hoard money. They put it to work for them. Like they know that they can put that money into something to invest in it, and they like to make it work. They don't sleep on it on their beds. Mm. They don't keep it in banks. They invest it, which puts it back into the economy and keeps it moving. And what I did to buy this house, because we had some money saved up as a deposit. First of all, the house wasn't overly expensive, which was useful. But actually, I used the retained profits in the business on paper to buy the house. So I didn't, to get the mortgage, I used a paper profit, which was a true profit. The money was there. We made it in the company. It was in the bank. We've got to pay bloody 19% corporation tax day after tomorrow, which is shit. But the money was in the bank, and I used the paper valuation for the mortgage companies to go, okay, cool, yeah, we'll lend you that, because we can see the money's in the business and it's fine,
right,
regardless of the fact the money could go tomorrow. Mm. It's a snapshot in time. So I think there's a lot of ways to work out how you can borrow money in those kind of situations, I think.
Mm. That's actually one of the things that interests me most, is because I've got involved with a property joint venture group where we're going to invest together. I can tell you about that another time, but it's the finance side of it actually interests me more than like the building side of it, you know, the idea of knowing people with money, connecting people with money with like that's really what interests me, you know, knowing where to go and get the money, you know, like that kind of excites me.
Yeah how to make the system work for you. And I think that's where the best will in the world, that the average layman doesn't understand how to do it. You're stuck in the system of, you have to have so much, you have to have 15-20% deposit saved, you can only borrow up to, you know, 3 times your earnings, and all that kind of stuff. But actually, whilst that's a standard, there are other ways around it, and it's about knowing how you do that. And to be honest, the more you have, the easier it becomes. Absolutely, that is true. You do reach a point where suddenly you can start putting your money to work for you. And I'll be honest, banks treat you so differently. We had a good chunk of money in our bank account. It was less than 100 grand, but it was more than 60. And we needed a new account set up, and the bank did it within half an hour. They set us up a brand new account within half an hour to help us with what we needed to do, purely because they could see in an account we had that much money. And they treated us so differently. And I've been treated so badly by banks in the past. And I remember turning around and saying to my wife, I was like, it is amazing, isn't it, how you get treated when you have money, which is totally the wrong way of doing business, but it's exactly the way the world works. But, you know, 4 years ago, I couldn't have done it. So,
hey, if you get a chance, I know you're busy, but have a listen to some of my episodes with Chris Gibbons. He's similar to you, actually. He helps grow businesses, and he takes a share in exchange and things like that. Really, kind of, it's really similar kind of stuff to what you're doing. Nice guy. And I'm kind of, it's really early stages, but I'm partnering up with him, and I'm going to do stuff in my region. He's based in Germany. And so, so we're going to have like a sort of partnership, and I'm going to sort of manage stuff. So yeah, you know, I don't really have any stories to tell on that yet, but sort of over the next year or two, you know, I'll be doing a lot more stuff. So
that's good. I listened to the podcast with the, actually I think I watched it with the lady who does the property investments.
Alex.
Yes.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah. So she's
I'd seen some of those.
She's the coach that's coaching us in the joint venture group. So still early days, you know, we haven't done anything yet, but this year hopefully I'll be making things happen.
Yeah, there's lots of gaps. I'll get you to come up at some point in the summer. I'll get you to come up and stay at my place for a couple of days, and it's perfect for some of you because I've got a pool and I've got a gym.
Wicked.
So, and we can chew the fat and throw around some different ideas, because there's loads of places to do different stuff. We've gone off the call a little bit now, but yeah there's loads of areas, and I found a real market. And I love what Gary Vaynerchuk does. So I think it's nice to keep saying, I love what he does in terms of just throwing out advice, because what's happened where he's thrown out all this advice, I throw out all my advice for free. People love him, and his brand has got so strong, so strong from that. But yeah, I mean, I generally just give away loads of different ideas that I've thought about to different people in meetings. Today I pitched to somebody. I was like, hey, if you want to make your building really work for you, contact Amazon, have it as an Amazon delivery center. And they just went, that's an ingenious idea. And they sort of looked at me like, hold on, are you going to try and trade that? I was like, no, it's yours. You go crazy. I don't care. Because you'll come back to me next time for other ideas, because you know I've got solid ideas. But buying heritage buildings and doing stuff with heritage buildings is a real good opportunity. I've said this to a few people, because there's funding in it, and you can buy them cheap generally, because they're quite they're seen as a liability, not an asset. But as long as you can figure out how to monetize it quickly, you can actually make it work for you. And there's not a lot of people playing in that market, so there's not a lot of competition.
Hey, I expect we'll end up doing a deal somewhere along the line. Who knows what, but we'll end up doing something. Hey, listen, we'll leave it there because it's getting late.
Worries.
But thanks, Joel. And
no worries, anytime.
We'll catch up again soon, and keep us updated with the progress.
Yeah, no, we'll do, definitely.
All right, great.
I'll let you tag all my channels. All right, take care,
Ben. Nice one. Cheers.
Cheers. Bye.